Hi, welcome to my garden. My name is Morten Albek. I live in Denmark, and this is the place where I grow my bonsai. I have a website that is called Shohin/Europe.com, and you can follow me there. I'm not a bonsai professional, but I teach a lot of bonsai. I write a lot about bonsai in articles in Bonsai Focus magazine and international magazines. I make videos and so on. I travel around the world teaching. And this is my small paradise, and I would like to invite you on a tour. My favorite thing is the small trees, the Shohin trees. And this is a Japanese maple. I have been grown from a very raw stock imported from Japan. But mostly I like to train my trees from very basic material. And I'm experimenting with some small amur maple forests. And these are seedlings just collected nearby, just maybe 50 yards from here in a local forest. Then I have planted them up and will make small forests from these. If you come with me over here. These are some of the other trees, the small Shohin I'm making. And most of my material is made from very basic nursery material. And I find something with an interesting trunk. I chop it back and then I begin rebuilding the branches from scratch. And this is a small cotonaster, and it is just starting blooming right now. In the autumn it will get small orange red berries that will stay through the winter for a nice winter display. This is one of my older trees and an example of the way I try to develop my trees from very raw material. This tree has been approximately the same height as me. It was chopped down, only leaving very few branches and in a very big pot. And then I have slowly regrown it by cutting it back, setting new branches, developing these, and step by step just minimizing it. So this tree has been with me. It is an European yew for maybe 20 years, starting as a big tree and now kept as a Shohin-sized tree. Another example is an Itoigama juniper that also has been a kind of a raw stock that I have styled for a magazine recently and hollowed out the trunk to make it more interesting. And this is at a stage where it's a little bit too big. It needs to be reduced maybe 30% more to be in a Shohin size and be more compact. But within 2 or 3 years, I think I managed to get it back in size. So the feeding program is very important, to feed them well so they are able to set new leaves. And the reason I do not cut it back at once is because all of the energy is at the tip of the foliage at junipers. So if I pinch it too heavily, it will just weaken and it will not set a new foliage in here. So it's about having a little bit too much foliage in the start and then slowly reducing it. And if we turn around, we have a native tree, and that is a much bigger tree. It's a birch collected just down the road last year. I built a slab for it, and now I will begin to train it into a pretty huge bonsai compared to the small Shohin. And the feature I like was this hollow part of the tree that has naturally died back. It has not been treated with anything, and it is actually hard as a rock, so it must be pretty old. I wonder if I have to treat it with something or just let it stay and maybe decay a little bit with time and accept this. The branches have to pull down and be developed. This is only 1 year from the collecting, so, and it is growing very well already. Another tree that is also old is this prunus. It's a native cherry with white flowers in the spring, and it has not been allowed to flower this year because normally it will have some small berries developing right now. But I wanted it to develop the branches instead, and every time you have a flower and a fruit, it takes the place of a branch. It's not. There's a little bit of a myth saying that the flower takes the energy of the tree, and that's not totally true. What it does is it takes the place for a branch to grow. So therefore, I have removed them so I can develop the branches instead. And it is very important with bonsai that you give them time to rest and regrow in between. So I will let it flower next year and having the fruits, and then the following 2 or 3 years I will again pull off the flowers to give it energy to grow. And this has been grown from a very ordinary, maybe 1 thumb thick plant I bought in a nursery 25 years ago. And today it has this wonderful, very old bark and trunk that has been developed in a pot. And you only get this wabi-sabi feeling, as the Japanese says, by growing them in a pot for a very, very long time. And this is what I like about bonsai, when you get to this stage and can see that your patience pays off after many years. And we take a tour around here. Just a newly collected forest, only collected last year at a field just beside our property here. And I'm beginning to try to make a forest, something I have never done before. So I like to try new things. And I think there's some interest in these mixed forests. And I have had the idea of doing this ever since I read a book with Saburo Kato from Japan that had a little book with a different forest in there. And for some reason I never did it, but this year I had to do it. Then, also an old tree that was going to be a bonsai within 5 or 10 years, I hope. This has been a very small piece, a thumb thick piece that I have been growing in the garden for some time. Dig it up in between, cutting the roots, putting back in ground to grow a thicker trunk. Now I have put it in the pot, and with a few years I will begin to train it more like a bonsai. Now I'm growing all the branches from scratch, and it has a very fat trunk, and I hope within maybe 1 or 2 years I'll get it in a wooden box and then later in a pot and make a nice Japanese maple, but in a much bigger size than the Shohin. In here, in this part of the garden, I start something. This is an azalea, just a cutting that has rooted, and I have some pre-bonsai that I'm beginning to develop. This is a pericanta that flowers with lovely white flowers and red berries in the autumn. Still in the training stage, but has developed a nice canopy at this time. And one of the things about developing Shohin is that you can have them in a pretty decent style for 2 or 3 or 4 years, and then you have to regrow them a little. They grow out of form, out of shape. Then you have to cut them back and begin rebuilding them. This one was pretty good for 3 years ago, and then I had to cut it back and rebuild some of the branch structure. So you can't have a bonsai that is pretty all the time. Sometimes they have to regain strength, and then you can put them in the perfect form for maybe 1, 2, 3 or 4 seasons, and then you have to rebuild again. The good thing about my climate is that it stays a little bit longer, because it is not as humid and as warm as in Japan, where they grow out of shape much too fast actually. Here we can have them a little longer in the same shape, but the development stage takes a longer time. So here I have different accents, and I have even very small marmot bonsai I'm developing. It's a Chinese elm, not very big, and building up. I have a potentilla, also not allowed to flower, simply because I need to make some branch development. It flowers with yellow flowers in the spring, normally. I have an Amor maple, or Amor maple, whatever you say, and I'm just grafting some new roots on here, so these will be left to grow freely for 2 or 3 years, and then I will cut them. And new roots will sit here where I have a gap I have to close. I have some larger trees, again forest styles that I talked about before that I like to do some more of. And I have a yew, and I have an azalea, And this is one of the drastic things I do when I like to do a Shohin tree, is that I look for a trunk and a specimen of interest, and then I cut it back. So within a week or two, I will cut this back to here. Simply cut up, chop it off, so you only have this piece left, and then it will begin to set new branches, and with time I will be able to make a new tree. And many of my trees is done this way. Finding a trunk of interest and chop it down and then rebuild it. It might seem pretty drastic, but it works. And if we go around here, this is also a Japanese maple, also a garden piece that I, the problem with these garden pieces often is that they are grafted. This one is not, because you have this ugly scar. You can see where the union is between the trunk and the branch that has been joined. But here I have a thing about the Japanese maples. You always have these huge flat roots, and I think they do not look very natural. I prefer this. I prefer they have this more natural look, but that's just a matter of taste. I think some of the Japanese ways is a little bit too artificial. I like it a little bit more relaxed, a little bit more natural, but not so natural that it is not trained. And then I have a collected tree. I styled this the first time 1.5 years ago. It's a Scots pine collected in Sweden, and I have made some really heavy bends on the trunk and some of the branches to make this dropping. It was just a straight trunk almost, and I chopped out a big part here, and this wire has to sit maybe for half or 1 year more at the main trunk. I will begin to remove the wire at the younger branches because they thicken up faster than the main trunk. And then I hope to make some kind of a semi-cascade tree here, like a little bit like a waterfall falling off. Another old tree, also a Shohin tree, that has matured in this pot. Also a very primitive tree that I just bought in a local nursery shop. A hawthorn with red flowers that flowers in the spring. And all of this very, very old bark is only developed this way and looking this natural because it has been grown in a pot for maybe 20 years. If you dig something of this character out of a garden with an old bark, the bark will be much more rough and much bigger and not have this naturalness that looks, you can see this is developed in the pot. And that takes really a long time. In the start it was totally smooth and uninteresting, but with time it begins to crack and develop and make this fantastic age that is very rare for a piece like this. These are also very often grafted, and you can see that this is on its own roots. The hawthorn with the red flowers have a weaker roots than the white flowering hawthorn. Therefore you often graft them onto these. But this is on its own root and has been with me for maybe 20 years in this size. This is also a way to get material, very inexpensive. If you know someone who is digging up something in your garden, I found this Cotuna aster. Was a guy told me he was leaving his ground so we can come and dig up everything, and much of it was like a finger, uninteresting. But this one was probably several trunks growing together. So this is actually a massive piece for a Cotuna aster. Dug it up 3 or 4 years ago, and now I'm beginning to develop a crown of it all. And we can finish up over here. This is my garden tokonoma, and as far as I know, I was the first one in the world who made a garden tokonoma. I was told that because I wanted a tokonoma. We have a small house. There was not room in the house to make a tokonoma. I always wanted to have one. So I think, why not build it in the garden instead? I'm here all the time. I want to present my trees. I want to sit on my bench and just look at my trees. And I think that's one of the things you often forget when you have bonsai, is just sitting and looking and not doing anything. Often we have to water, we are cutting something away, or we're styling something, or we're doing something. But just sitting and enjoying them and look at them is something I think we forget in between. So I built this garden in Tokonoma, and I can see people around the world is beginning to build them in the garden. And some Japanese folks wrote to me and said, "Why? Where do you have this idea from?" "Nowhere," I said. "I just wanted it in my garden." So maybe they even will go to Japan. You never know. In the Tokonoma, there is a forest of Japanese maples put on a slab, and a small action planting and a scroll that is saying something about spring and the year cycles. And this is all about what my garden is. I love this changing seasons in the garden. I hope you enjoyed this tour, and thank you for watching. And if you ever come to Denmark, give me a call or a message, and you are welcome to stop by.